All right. So I will go back over. I will add those questions at the end of the lecture, I promise. Help me. I'll start right there. Playful screen. Thank you, Brian. So I was saying that Elvis, don't go anywhere. I'm having a day. Well, all right. I'll include those, I promise. All right. So, Elvis continued to play regularly on the hayride and comes to the attention of a gentleman who would sign on as Elvis's manager and work with Elvis until his death. His name is Colonel Tom Parker. We only missed a couple of questions, so that's good. Colonel Tom Parker was a manager for a number of acts who played on the Hayride radio show. Elvis and his band continued to travel and play shows with other Hayride artists, but the crowds are beginning to really notice Elvis more than anyone else, especially with young girls and teenagers who are knocking down barriers to try and get to him. His sexy moves, which you'll see in a little bit, good looks, that's Colonel Tom Parker, but I'll get to that. His sexy moves, good looks, and unusual rockabilly musical style starts to cause more and more excitement wherever he plays. Rockabilly is just a combination of rock and what they called hillbilly music. But hillbilly being an old derogatory term for a person from a rural area. So, here's another test question. Elvis Presley helped to move rock and roll into the mainstream when he moved from a small independent label to a major label, record label, I can't spell, record label known as...
Sir, can I see the lecture?
RCA, huh?
I cannot see the lecture.
Oh, I'm having a bad one. I'm sorry, guys. I'm not sharing with you guys anymore. Who's on first? Now can you see it?
Yeah. Can you go back
okay.
to the question?
Hmm?
Can you go back to the question, please?
Yes, I'm going to go. In fact, let me do this right now. I'm going to stop what I'm doing. I'm going to go back to one, two. There are only two questions before this one. So we're going to look at both questions. I'm going to make sure that you can see, play full screen. The first question, let me just make sure, I'm going all the way back. This is the first question. True or false? When Elvis made his first rock and roll records for Sam Phillips at Sun Records, the flip side or B-sides were all country tunes. And the answer is true. Okay, the next question was, Elvis Presley helped to move rock and roll into the mainstream when he moved from a small independent label to a major record, label known as... We are missing one question. RCA. Let me see what that other question was, because there was one other question, and I don't want you guys to not have... No? Let me just make sure I'm right.
Sun Records.
Yeah. Thank you! And it's in the lecture.
In the beginning of the video.
You're right. Somebody's, I love you. Don't get old. All right. Question. Sam Phillips was the owner and producer of an independent record. What happened with record? Label called Sun Records. Boom. Okay. So let me try and get back to where I was. Blue moon, all of that. We saw, we answered that question. We were talking about the colonel right here. This is Tom Parker. And I want to get back to exactly where we were so that. All right. We got there. Okay, so I was around here. Colonel Tom Parker was manager for a number of acts who played on the Hayride radio show. Elvis and his band continued to travel and play shows with other Hayride artists, but the crowds are beginning to really notice Elvis more than anyone else, especially with young girls and teenagers who are knocking down barriers to try to get to him. His sexy moves, good looks, and unusual rockabilly musical style starts to cause more and more excitement wherever he plays. And I've mentioned what rockabilly is, a combination of rock and hillbilly music. Then I told you about that was the next test question, right? So we looked at that, and I'm not going to repeat that again because I did twice now. RCA Records. So, yes. So RCA Records, which here's the logo. It should be coming up. Yes. RCA Records acquired Elvis for the price of $40,000. By today's standards, that would be about $350,000. So Elvis signing to RCA in 1955 would be a major milestone and turning point in popular music history. One might think this was no big deal for RCA, but in fact, it was because no major record label had ever done this before in rock and roll. So you can say, again, there should be another test question coming up. That's him on RCA. RCA Records made a bold move in 1955 by signing Elvis Presley. Now, someone might wonder why, what happened with Sun Records and Sam Phillips after Elvis leaves and goes with RCA. In the case of other stories like this, usually the small independent labels continue on for a while and then eventually shut down their business. But Sam Phillips and Sun Records did very well. And there's another test question coming up, and it's relevant to this. It should be. One, and I'll give you a list of them. One of the artists Sam Phillips signed after selling Elvis Presley's contract was, and there's several, so the test will allow you to give one. Carl Perkins, and I'll give you pictures of each one of them. Johnny Cash, Jerry Lee Lewis, or Roy Orbison. And we're going to look at all of them at some point. That's Carl Perkins, Blue Suede Shoes. And Johnny Cash is Johnny Cash, without question. And Jerry Lee Lewis, you saw yesterday. And Roy Orbison is going to come up. Pretty amazing voice. All members of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, all of these guys. So Sam Phillips made out okay without Elvis. Back to Elvis and another avenue he would use to build his career. Remember, we talked about commercial radio, television. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Commercial network TV programs did not begin in the US until 1948. Elvis would become the first rock and roll star to use television to skyrocket his career. He appeared on Milton Berle's show twice, and the second time he drives the kids in the crowd crazy with his hip shaking and wild moves. So here's Milton Berle talking about
it. Well, when you're talking about Elvis Presley, you're talking about the king, and you're talking about one of the nicest young men I ever met. And it's a little long, but the story, and I gotta be on the set in December, but I'll tell it to you anyway. He had a manager called Colonel Parker, Tom Parker. And I was with the William Morris Agency, which is a great agency, especially the agents there. Every Tuesday, they say, have a nice weekend. And somebody from the agency, I think it was Harry Kalchheim or somebody, said, I just heard from Colonel Parker. He wants you to audition somebody. I said, who? He said, well, I don't know, some young fellow, he's from down south. Elvis something. I said, Elvis, that's his name? Elvis? Yeah. And I took the rehearsal studio again on 7th Avenue, the one from way back, and I auditioned him. And he's jiving and he's shaking and he's wiggling and he's wriggling, he's doing his style. And I said, hey, he's handsome, he's good looking, he's got a different sound and all that. So I booked him on a show on the, not the Texaco show, this is in the 50s. Oh, I booked him from a carrier. And I remember who's on the show, Harry James, Buddy Hackett. Joe Williams was singing, and Buddy Rich was at the drums, and Esther Williams, and the extra added attraction was Elvis Presley. Nobody knew who the hell he was. And he walked in very, bashful, good-looking, very cute, and he just handed Harry James for the rehearsal one sheet of music, a sheet. He said, well, where's the orchestration? He says, this is it. Played a guitar. Oh. Bottom line. He goes on. 10 days later, I got about 400,000 pan letters. Not fan letters, pan letters, and blaming me. We'll never watch you again, Uncle Milty, when you put that vulgar man that jives and wiggles his backside and his butt. It's disgusting. Oh, the pan letters get worse, and they're blaming me. Well, I got a 500,000. I had to put people on to open them. 500,000 letters on that, blaming me about Presley. Without a butt. Just turn around, I got on the phone, and I called Colonel Parker. I said, I have in front of me here in the office, hundreds of thousands of letters. Oh, he's about Elvis? I said, yeah, but they're all pan letters. They're not, what do you mean pan letters? I said, all I called you up is to this, to tell you this, Colonel, you have a star on your hands. Right? You get a 500,000 letters. And somebody that must be on everybody's mind and everybody's tongue, you know, you got a star. So that's what I, and this is before he went on the Sullivan show and Sullivan put the screen in front of him so he wouldn't let the audience see him wiggle. But that's the truth about Presley.
So I don't know if this is the one I want to show you. I'm going to talk about it, but obviously, we know that even today, if somebody is a button pusher, that always works to their advantage. You know what I mean? And so Elvis was a button pusher, not intentionally. He didn't say, he just did what Elvis does. But needless to say, that was the beginning of a very, very long, successful career. Here he is. This is Steve Allen. So he makes an appearance on the Steve Allen Show and is instructed not to shake his hips and make any wild moves. So, okay.
And that was with the great vocal group, the George Mayers, in the background. Elvis, your new record hit, I predict it's going to be one because I've heard you rehearse it. You're going to record it tomorrow, called Hound Dog. I got you a very cute little hound dog right here. And away you go. Who's that?
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit, and you ain't no friend of mine. Well, I said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, you ain't never caught a rabbit, and you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit, and you ain't no friend of mine. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Yeah, you ain't never caught a rabbit, and you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't never caught a rabbit, you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound.
Now, we just saw Steve Allen yesterday. He was not a big fan of rock and roll. He was a jazz guy. And so he knew that Elvis was super popular. So he was going to try and humiliate him. And Elvis later remarked, it was one of, if not, the most embarrassing moment in his career. But at this point, it doesn't matter, right? So eventually, the most popular TV show, which was Ed Sullivan, would sign Elvis to a 3-performance deal worth $50,000, which at the time was a ridiculous amount of money, which it was far more than anyone else had ever been paid to perform on television. Ed Sullivan had earlier sworn that he would never have Elvis on his show because of his disgusting ways. After seeing the ratings Elvis was getting on other shows, he changed his mind. Ed Sullivan also said Elvis was a fine young man after finally meeting him, and probably after seeing the ratings. Elvis appeared in September of 1956 on the Ed Sullivan Show. That can be considered America's introduction to the birth of the King of Rock and Roll. And this should be it.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, yes, that's right, Elvis Presley.
Ladies and gentlemen, could I have your attention, please? I'd like to tell you that we're going to do a sad song for you. This song here is one of the saddest songs we've ever heard. It really tells a story, friends. Beautiful lyrics. It goes something like this.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Well, you ain't
like to tell you, friends. I'd like to tell you, please, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to tell you that on Thanksgiving Day, I think that our new picture is to be released. And also, we'll be back with Mr. Ed Sullivan in January. I'd like to thank all the millions of wonderful people that are watching in tonight, friends. And I'd like to say this, until we meet you again, may God bless you as he's blessed me. Thank you very much.
So, do you find what his movement offensive? You have to, everything's relative. It's like, oh my God. People found this offensive and disgusting. Okay. So
I found his dancing pretty offensive, personally. It wasn't too great.
But wait a minute. But didn't you see Bruno Mars? You know, at age whatever it was, imitating that. But that's it, you know, that's what people looked at that and said, oh my God, what is he doing? That's disgraceful. Anyway, so this is relative. And this is rock and roll, which was supposed to be a flash in the pan. This is early rock and roll. His music was supposed to happen and then disappear. It was going to be a fad. Needless to say, it wasn't. Anyway, Elvis had always expressed an interest in acting. His newfound popularity, as well as his good looks, would be a drawing card for the motion picture studio. His first movie was called Love Me Tender, and the name of the movie was changed to coincide with his hit song, and we're going to listen to it. Called Love Me Tender.
Love me tender, love me sweet, never let me go. You have made my life complete, and I love you so. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you. And I always will. Love me tender, love me long. Take me to your heart. For it's then that I belong and will never part. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will. Love me tender, love me dear. Tell me you are mine. I'll be yours through all the years, till the end of time. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams fulfill. For my darling, I love you, and I always will.
So I don't remember the exact premise of the movie, but I think I saw the movie as a kid or something. Anyway, the movie is a smash hit. And Elvis performed several other songs in it. Elvis would go on to make a bunch of movies, but later in his career, many of the movies were not well received, but the fans still loved them because they loved Elvis. But 1956 was a turning point in his career. He was the primary symbol of the new youth culture in America, and he had become one of society's most controversial figures. Presley's blending of country music, rock and roll, gospel, rhythm and blues, and pop music, along with his charisma, talent, controversy, and success, would change American pop culture and society forever. What happens next? What happens next? Level fans, and even those who do not really follow Elvis's musical career, wonder what happened, because Elvis was notified by the draft board in 1957. He was being drafted into the Army, where he served from 1958 to 1960. Most of the time was spent in Germany, where he was greeted widely by his fans upon arrival. There he is. Elvis served his time in the Army and was discharged in 1960 as a sergeant. Elvis wondered if his popularity would still be strong after being away from his public. But they would respond strongly, because his first recording after leaving the service went to number one after only 3 weeks on the chart. Elvis continued to make movies and recordings, and his popularity after his time in the Army was a big or bigger success. His popularity... Yes?
Sorry, I had a question. This wasn't him going to the Army. That was like the inspiration for Bye Bye Birdie, right?
No. No. No, maybe. Actually, hold that thought. Let me get through this. We're going to go back and look. See, you should never say those things to me. I'm curious.
What's that?
It may be. And I'm
gonna... I thought it was.
Well, let's...
Maybe not.
No, let's confirm. Don't know. No, 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 no. This I like. Let me finish this, because there's not that much. And I'm going to play one more song, and then we're going to look. I think you're right. I actually think you're right. All right, so I don't want to lose this, because I don't know if there's any more questions. I think there are, but let's see. Yes. His popularity would grow, and then in the early 60s, things would begin to change. Culture and music were evolving again, and Elvis was, for the most part, only making movies and soundtrack recordings for those movies. No public performances to speak of. He wasn't really performing live. After not performing live for a number of years, things would change. You saw him later on. The decision to get back to performing live would take place in a big way in 1968. Commonly called the 68 Special. I don't know if I have those pictures here. I may not. Wait, no, I don't. Commonly called the 68 Special or the 68 Comeback, a television special was in the works. Elvis is ready to perform again in a live concert setting on television, but is nervous about how he will be received. The biggest stars are on hand for the show, and it showcases Elvis doing what he always did: sing, play, and do songs that he loved from the early years of his career. He never sounded better and seemed at peace and at ease with himself after years of movie making and Hollywood glitz. This show and performance went down in history as one of the great musical moments. And if I find it online, I'll put in a link, 68. If you're interested. It went down as one of the great musical moments in TV music history. Elvis put all his energy into performing live, and his career takes off again. We saw some of his performance, you know, at the beginning of the class. We're going to check out one more recording, and then there's one more little bit I want to talk about. This was actually from a movie, and it was a hit. And I'm going to check on that while
gentlemen, a little while back, I had a kind of a vacation with a bunch of men in a big place away out yonder. And while I was there, these men kind of guest, you might say. Well, we'd get together and horse around a little bit and sing, and because we were having such a good time. And, well, we always had a lot of fun with this one. The Jailhouse Rock.
It's funny, prison never looked like that. You, Andrew, you were spot dead on. We're going to watch video. While we're sitting here, this is what I love because, like I told you in the beginning, I don't know everything. I don't. And I actually used to love that movie, Bye Bye Birdie. I'll play the song. Just one little, few little things I want to make a point about. In the early 70s, Elvis began playing in Vegas and Lake Tahoe casinos and broke all attendance records. His concerts in Madison Square Garden sold out, and the performances everywhere he played were hugely successful. His live performances were going great, but record sales were not, and his life would begin to unravel little by little. In 1975, I don't think I have any more pictures. I don't think I do.
Thank you, Mr. Everett. Very good, Jack, but a couple of your dances missed their marks and we lost them.
Yeah, I do. I lied. In 1975 would be the first time that Elvis had to cancel a performance because of illness from addiction. The ironic thing is that Elvis wrote a letter to President Richard Nixon asking him to let him help out with the war on drugs. Figure that. The two actually met, and Presley convinced President to give him a badge from the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs. Elvis also asked to be a federal agent at large for the Bureau. Needless to say, that didn't happen. During the course of the next 2 years, Elvis could be found in various stages of, degeneration. It was often reported, I'm sorry, that he was not able to carry on a coherent conversation. And even at his performances, he seemed out of it. The drugs would eventually take their toll on him, and his health would begin a final downward spiral. There would be no more comebacks after this. Elvis died of a heart attack at Graceland, his home, in August of 77. A couple of weeks before his death, Elvis was quoted as saying, "I've been lucky, and you know something? I just feel sometimes it's all been a dream. I like rub my eyes and wake up one day and it'll all be over. I hope not. I hope it never ends. I hope it never ends." It's as if he never died. I don't know how to describe this. The presence of people like going to Elvis conventions and that kind of stuff, and it's spooky. It's spooky. You know, his clothing, if you find a piece of his clothing, it's worth a small fortune. He just, and I said in the beginning, probably one of the most imitated people on the planet. There's a guy that lives down here that rents a billboard. If you're driving down 95, at a certain time of year, he does these big tribute concerts, and it's scary. But, you know, love is love. Now, let's play that video. So for those of you who don't know, I want to find it. I thought that was the coolest thing. Anne Margaret, bye-bye Birdie.
$12 for your first year when you select automatic renewal.
I'll just play the theme from it. Bye-bye Birdie. His name in the... in the movie was Conrad Birdie. So let's see. So this is a theme from Bye Bye Birdie. I'm having one of those days. It's the ghost of Elvis. Nope. I'm having a day. Sorry. Where did it go? I'm gonna try this one more time. Thank you. Why does it do that? So we won't watch it full screen. Because I don't know why it's doing that. And then you need to see Conrad Birdie. We'll be right back.
each time you move those lips, no more dying. When you twitch those hips, you swivel and you sway. You're super duper class. There's nothing left to say, but Conrad, you're a gas.
Let me see if I can find Conrad Birdie. Conrad Birdie. All right. Just a snippet of Conrad Birdie and we'll be done, I promise. There is Conrad. Wait, is this the one we want? We love you, Conrad. Oh, yes, we do. I actually remember that. Let me see if this is...
Take control of your brain health with Staying Sharp. Included with your AAR...
He's not so much.
You gotta be sincere.
Edna, what's wrong?
You gotta be sincere.
Birdie, what are you doing?
You gotta feel it here. Cause if you feel it here, well then you're gonna be honestly sincere. If what you feel is true, you really feel it, you make them feel it too. Write this down now, you gotta be sincere, honestly sincere. Man, you gotta be. If you're really sincere, if you feel it in here, and it's gotta be right off, baby. Oh, honey, hug me. I suffer. In everything I do, why my sincerity shows through. Yeah, I look you in the eye. I don't even have to try. It's automatic, I'm sincere. When I sing about a tree, listen, I really feel that tree. Yeah, when I sing about a girl, I really feel that girl. I mean, I really feel sincere. If you feel it in here, and it's gotta be right out, baby. Oh, honey, hug me. I suffer. Yeah, here we go now. Why, you gotta be sincere. Huh? You gotta feel it here. Oh, my baby. Oh, my baby. Oh, yeah. Oh, my baby. Oh, yeah. Are you gonna be sincere? Are you gonna be sincere?
Yeah!
Are you gonna be sincere? Are you gonna be sincere?
Yeah!
Are you gonna be sincere? Are you gonna be sincere?
Yeah!
Oh, my baby! Oh, yeah! Oh, my baby! Oh, yeah! Oh, my baby! Oh, yeah! Are you gonna be sincere? Are you gonna be sincere? Oh, my baby!
This personifies the acceptance of Elvis Presley. I had totally forgotten about this movie. Thank you, Andrew. I want to go back and watch it. It's silly because if you look at, I mean, just the history of rock and roll, we're just starting. We're just scraping the surface. But if you look at it, at every juncture, there's some resistance. There's resistance to the music is offensive. The movement is offensive. The people making the music are offensive. This music is not going to last. It's not important. What are you doing? It's a fad. It's going to go away. This happens at every juncture. Trust me. But then people go, I'm looking at back at this. I'm looking at Elvis swivel his hips. You guys are like so far removed from this. I'm not offended by that. But there were people that took offense. And I think in part it symbolizes people were uncomfortable with change. Yeah, I think we're all in agreement there. So let me give you a question and send you guys on your merry way. Who was Elvis's manager? And the answer is Colonel Tom Parker. I promise tomorrow I will not be as hopefully, who knows. I had a, I before we meet, I walk every morning, about 3 or 4 miles. And I put my keys around my neck so that they don't fall out. And I got all the way home and realized where I left my keys. So I had to walk all the way back. So I think that that helped to scramble my brain today. But so the question was, who was Elvis's manager? And the answer was Colonel Tom Parker. Okay? So tomorrow we will look at whitening. That's not an offensive term, folks. Crickets, Big Bopper, and La Bamba. Okay? Have a great rest of the day. I hope you got your fill of Elvis today. And I think I'm going to watch Bye Bye Birdie. Find out. Any questions, comments? If not, you guys are free to go. Please put the question in the chat. And I will see you guys tomorrow. And all the questions are in this lecture. A little jumbled, but they're there. Okay? See you tomorrow. I'm going to stop sharing. And I'll make sure that you guys are there. I don't see any. Oh, Angela? Angelina? Angelina. Let me stop recording.